discuss with on the in continuation on that supply chain management and all in the e-business that we have discussed, that is the core, one of the main component. Anyone can start a website, a e-commerce store, and people start selling on the Facebook pages and even on WhatsApp also by making groups and connecting with the manufacturers directly, and they are selling, right? And but what we need is we need supply chain solutions. Who is going to deliver these products or products, physical products? How the company is delivering physical products, how they are integrating with multiple courier partners and all, with the technology. Basically, they are, again, the applications are developed, have been developed, and multiple courier partners have been integrated for national and international shipments, right? And that we have discussed on supply chain solutions on e-business models. Now, today we will start with structural concepts to deliver value. Structural concepts to deliver value, core competencies. What is the structure? How you are delivering? If you own a small e-commerce store with a WordPress website, and what exactly you are specialized in, what you are delivering, how you are saying that you are delivering value to your customers, why your customers are going to pay you in long run, right? That we need to understand basically how you are delivering value, right? And for that, the effective delivery of value to a customer requires that the company organize its structure and functions according to the type of product or offering delivered. Effective, if when we talk about delivering value, the effective way of delivering value requires should be customized as per the product or services company product or services company delivering, right? That we need to know about, and we have to customize how we are going to deliver value. And the value chain has popularized by Michael Porter describes a linear set of steps which would be activities or business processes such as design, production and sales whereby a manufacturing company delivers value. For Michael Porter's have describes quite a lot in value chain, value delivery process, and that value chain he basically focused about manufacturing companies, products, right? Production companies. You all of know about Michael Porter's value chain. What are the five steps of Michael Porter's value chain and value delivery process? Anyone can answer?
No, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes, please.
Basic needs, psychological needs.
No, that's not. That's, they are. This is.
Please
for manufacturing company. Better internet. प्रॉब्लम हो सकती है मे बी ऑन योर साइड और मे बी ऑन मेरी तरफ तो ठीक लग रहा है फिलहाल तो मुझे और किसी को आवाज कटी भी लग रही है क्या नहीं लग रही तो तुम्हारी तरफ इंटरनेट कनेक्टिविटी है थोड़ा इधर उधर हिल लो राइट तो माइकल पोर्टर्स वैल्यू चेन दे ही सेड अबाउट फाइव स्टेप्स स्टार्ट्स विथ इनबाउंड लॉजिस्टिक्स इनबाउंड लॉजिस्टिक हम किसको कहते हैं इनबाउंड लॉजिस्टिक्स इज बेसिकली प्रोक्योरमेंट Right, procurement means purchasing raw materials, purchasing of components in manufacturing. This all is called inbound logistics or procurement, right? So inbound logistics is the first step in Michael Porter's value chain. Then production, operations basically. We purchase the raw material, we purchase components, that now we are working on these components of this raw material, right? So that is making the final group. Product involved in the operations is making raw materials, converting raw materials and components into a finished goods. Includes designing R&D on the product and manufacturing in all. That is, we give the name inventory management in all. We give the name operations. The first step is inbound logistics. Second is operations. The third one is outbound logistics. Now, your company manufactured Tata in Pannagar manufacturing trucks. So they outsource what? Inbound logistics is purchasing raw material and components from vendors. Operations is assembling all those things, manufacturing within a manufacturing plant or there, making the finished goods product, a truck. Now, the outbound logistics is delivering these trucks to dealerships or distributors all over the India or the markets abroad, outside India and other countries. So that is all we say outbound logistics. Outbound logistics, right? The next, this is the third steps in Michael Porter's value chain. The fourth one is marketing and sales. You market or sell the product when you have it, right? So this is marketing and sales is the fourth step in value chain. And service is the final fifth step is Michael Porter's value chain. That is the Michael Porter's value chain. You will go through somewhere in the sales this semester on production management or in any other subject about Michael Porter's value chain. The value chain as popularized by Michael Porter, this is the five-step value chain you can note down, that is inbound logistics, operations, outbound logistics, sales and marketing, service. So these are the five steps, right? The value chain as popularized by Michael Porter describes a linear set of steps. Linear set of steps. These all five steps are independent of each other. These all five steps are independent of each other. If you are running a company, if you are manufacturing a small product, maybe anything, assembling something at your place, at your right, you started some entrepreneurship with assembling some small product, maybe purchasing some raw materials and assembling sanitizer, we can say 100 ml or 50 ml of sanitizer bottles, right? Today we can say that, take the example. So purchasing, inbound logistic will be the purchasing raw materials. So you are purchasing sanitizer liquid from someone manufacturing in bulk. Then you are purchasing bottles of 50 ml from somewhere in bulk. Then you are filling these bottles and sealing them. This is inbound logistic is purchasing bottles and sanitizer. Outbound will be what? Sorry, operations will be filling these small bottles of 50 ml from that bulk purchased. This will be operations, packing them, then packing them and all, packaging them in cartons of 2 liter or 3 liter, maybe 20 bottles, 50 bottles, 100 bottles, you may be making a different size. And then outbound logistics will be sending them these cartons of 20, 50, 100 bottles of 50 ml to different places or some dealers or distributors you tied with, right? That is another process. So these are three processes. Fourth one is marketing and sales. How you are doing marketing and sales for that? That is independent of all three. And similarly, the last one is what? Service. So these all five processes in Michael Porter's value chain are independent of each other, and you can outsource any one of them. That is, you can outsource inbound logistics, you can give outsourcing. You all of may be knowing about what is outsourcing. Outsourcing means when we purchase from someone else, when we give order to someone else, right? And you can outsource the operations even. Means you are purchasing liquid sanitizer in bulk in 100 liters cane and also purchasing 50 ml bottles and telling someone, some third party. You are hiring 3-4 laborers, take it at your home, pack them in small bottles and again fill small 50 ml bottles, then pack them in cartons of 20, 50 and 100 50 ml bottles. So then come with a truck loaded with that or a small truck, whatever. So that is the operation part you have given someone else, 3-4 of your laborers are working at their place, filling the sanitizer, and that is operations part you have outsourced, right? Operation you have outsourced there, or maybe you are outsourcing outbound logistics, maybe you are outsourcing marketing. So this is, these all fives are independent of each other. The value chain, as popularized by Michael Porter, describes a linear set of steps which would be activities or business processes such as design, production, and sales, whereby a manufacturing company delivers value. So this is the way Michael Porter explains how the manufacturing companies can deliver values. This value chain delivery model strives for overall efficiency and cost reduction by increasing the efficiency and reducing the cost of each business process. So we are talking about five processes, and we can optimize, we have to optimize every process so that we can reduce the cost of inbound, cost of outbound, cost of operations or marketing or service, right? Each step is independent and separable, and it can be outsourced or contracted out to another company. In Michael Porter's value chain, each step is independent and separable, as I explained, and can be outsourced or contracted out to another company, right? The value chain becomes a supply chain when a company uses the inputs and activities of other companies in its manufacturing process. So this is value chain becomes supply chain. When a company uses inputs and activities of other company in its manufacturing process, right? Mostly everyone uses the supply chain is, right? The value chain, we use the processes of other company. Structural concept to deliver, that is continuing the next slide also. However, the value chain does not appear to describe how many service-oriented business operate. How service-oriented business, how will operate? The value chain given by Michael Porter focuses on manufacturing-based companies, as I already told. So, Stemmel and Feldstein, Timmers and Afuha and Tusi have developed additional concepts of value shop. These are the people. They have developed an additional concept of value shop in place of value chain and value network. Two more concepts, value shop and value network, following the work of Thompson to address other types of businesses apart from manufacturing. The value shop, now what is that value shop? The value shop describes a service operation. Means value shop is for a service operation, as the value chain is for manufacturing operations, and the value shop will describe and will tell more about a value, a service operation. And the subject is e-commerce, and basically the e-commerce business we are talking about, we are selling online and all, that is basically a service operation. So we have to understand here the value shop. The value shop describes a service operation such as a consulting, law or accounting firm that focuses on customer needs rather than on the production process of the value chain. So we are not focusing on production process. We are focusing on customer needs, and that is even value, even service-based operations. If we'll talk about a product, then we will talk about value chain by Michael Porter. If you are talking about a service, then we will talk about value shop, right? And the e-business setup as a value shop works directly with customer. E-business setup with value shop works directly with customer to provide a necessary, often unique solution. In e-business, we are trying to provide necessary and unique solution. Necessary and unique means customized solution to every customer's client. The value shop is generated to solve specific client problems rather than to make a common solution more efficient. So we are not focusing on common solutions, we are focusing on specialized I even told you and suggested you, if any one of you wants to start an entrepreneurship on e-business, because you can start with a small e-commerce website in 5-8,000 rupees. So you should focus on a particular niche. You should focus on solving particular problem of the customers. Don't try to be Amazon with integrating all the products in your store. The value shop describes a service operation such as a consulting law accounting firm that focuses on customer needs rather than on the production process of value chain. The value network is a type of e-business. Now we are talking about value network. A type is a type of e-business where network users negotiate a transaction on a website. Negotiating transaction, auctions and all, the pricing method we have discussed. Auction, right. The value network hosts online auctions, brokering, brokerage, market making, intermediation, right, or other types of transactions. Brokering, market making, right, auctions, like the share market, like not share market, as we can say different. This is we call value network, is a type of e-business where network users negotiate a transaction on a website. The value network hosts online auctions, broking, market making, intermediation, or other types of transactions. So the value, right? The value shop or value network focuses on individual customer basis, especially when we talk about value shop in service industry. Right. Depending on the business model, several revenue sources. Now, this is the conclusion about delivering structural concept to deliver value. So how, what are the concept you are using to deliver value? If we are talking about value shop or value network, so we should focus on individual customers. We should not try to duplicate a solution to every customer, right? We should try to give focus on individual customers' problem in service industry, in value shopping, in value shop. Similarly, in value network, right? User negotiate a transaction on website. So this is about structure, concept, delivering value. How? Concept. What is the concept? You are delivering value to customers in your e-business. Now, what will be the sources of revenue? What will be the sources of revenue, right, in a business model? In a business model, depending on the business model, several revenue sources may be available to an e-business. Several revenue sources, multiple revenue sources may be available. And this is depends upon the business model. What is your business model exactly? Many online businesses will have a 3 or 4 of these sources. We'll discuss multiple sources and maybe multiple sources of revenue making. Or maybe normally we have multiple sources of revenue making. A mix of revenue sources is often referred to as a revenue model. Revenue model, right? And some of these sources of revenue are, these are advertising is a source of revenue, as we discussed in last semester on digital marketing, Google AdSense. Mostly, even if you start in e-commerce, suppose you started a website, making of a website, e-commerce store. We should show e-commerce store instead of website if you are selling product or services on your store. If we have a shopping cart and all, it may be a subscription or maybe something. So if you are selling less but getting the traffic on your website slowly, you can go for Google AdSense or other partnership program for earning revenue by advertising on your store. Even IndiaMart you can check it with IndiaMART.com is a B2B portal. We all know it, IndiaMART.com, and thousands of manufacturers and suppliers are registered with IndiaMART.com. You will find a lot of revenue they are generating. Still, they are generating, trying to generate revenue using the advertising. You will find advertising on their websites. Right? That is a source of generating revenue. If you are getting traffic on your website, definitely you will be able to generate revenue on your e-commerce store using advertising. And Google pays more the clicks. If someone clicks for a product on your store and reaches to Amazon, so Google pays more on product weights, to pays more to product based websites. Right? So advertising is one way of making revenue. Affiliation is a big way of making revenue. So you may be running affiliate program with Amazon on your website. Right? Affiliate program means you have affiliation partnership with Amazon. You can easily subscribe for that. It means I'm telling you the multiple ways. If you are investing 500,000-600,000 rupees, then you can start your e-commerce store. You can go for Google AdSense. It means you are advertising, allowing Google to advertise on your store. That is one way of making revenue. The first way of making revenue is by selling products that you are selling on your store. The second is advertising. The third one is you can partner with Amazon, and if you means Amazon products will be there on your store. If someone clicks on these products or these categories and reaches to Amazon, then and purchase and going for a purchase within 24 hours, then Amazon will pays to you commissions. That is affiliate program. We say about it. Affiliate program. Not only Amazon, others are also using that affiliate program. Also, other e-commerce store are also offering such affiliation program. Right? So advertising is one way of making revenue. Affiliation is one way of making revenue. Agent commissions is one way of making revenue. You may be working as a drop shipping. In India, people are working as retailers. That is, they are only selling someone else's product, and the money even goes directly to the seller, and you are getting your commission only. Licensing. Many companies are providing license for online sales on services. That is one way of making revenue. Sales commissions and agenting that we have discussed. Sales profits on the sales. If you are selling product, then definitely will be making profits. Sponsorships. Someone may sponsor you. Right, depends upon a different business. Subscription based, right? If you are making a store, learning basically, and it is will be subscription based learning. It is like Amazon Prime, that is a subscription based. Netflix, subscription based. Any such thing you can provide, or email, or a lot of softwares are there. They are working on subscription based. Syndication is basically aggregation and aggregating with some other similar business owners, right? And you can this can be one way of making revenue. Use fees. You may be charging. Use fee means you may be charging for content. If someone reading, someone downloading something or something else, you may have hosted some special video series and all, lot of stuffs you can develop, and which people are selling on the basis of a particular fee. So this can be one way of making revenue, right? So these are the different ways of making revenue on e-business. And normally businesses use a combination of three, four, maybe using advertising, affiliation, and sales profits, maybe three. Combination of those three maybe using fees and advertising and affiliation, may be a combination of these three. A combination of three, four, normally people use, right? Businesses are using a combination of these three, four, maybe someone may be starting with two, combination of two things, right? So this is basically how they are generating revenue. So sources of revenue, these are the different sources of, means not only the selling of product is making profit by selling a product, is not only the source of revenue. The source of revenue may be advertising, may be affiliate program, may be sales profit commissions, and right? So these things can be used. These are the different ways of making revenue on a business, right? The activities, resources. Now the next topic, subtopic is activities, resources and capabilities, right? Activities, resources and capabilities. That just have a fresh look on the model we have initially. The activities, first day we have discussed e-business concepts and value proposition, right? Now sources of revenue we have discussed, value proposition, sources of revenue we just discussed. Now the fourth one is activities, resources and capabilities, right? This is the e-business model and we are explaining this. The next section is activities, resources and capabilities. The activities, resources and capabilities of a business are sometimes known as its requirements. Resources, also known as requirement. Activities, you'll be performing many activities in a business. Capabilities, right? In order to perform the activities required to carry out the mission of the business, certain resources are needed. For example, employees, human resource, right? Employees are human resources. Employees with certain skills, basically. We will say human resource if they have some skills, right? Or capabilities, skills or capabilities are needed to perform activities correctly and efficiently. Correctly and efficiently, both the things. Both the words are important. They must perform the activities correctly and as well as efficiently, in efficient manner, so that the business can be in profitable conditions. So to be in profitable condition, right, the activities must be performed efficiently. Activities are specific business processes or groups, like operations. In Michael Porter's value chain, operations is one step and multiple activities we perform within that. The activities are specific business processes, converting one raw material to finished goods or raw material to a component. Activities are specific business processes or groups of processes, such as design, production and sales, that implement the business concept. So activity, sales activity, production activity, design activity, marketing activity, right? Services and activity. The operational business model identifies the cost and outputs of each activity. The operational business model, operational, which is operational business model identifies, if we talk about the business plan making and all, the operational business model, cost of output, how much this output will cost. If I am going to manufacture this particular product, then what will be the cost of manufacturing total? The operational business model identifies the cost and outputs of each activity. I have discussed activity-based costing is one man in a cost way of costing is in cost accounting. The finance students may be their subject cost accounting or management account or management accounting. So we study activity-based costing means how much cost will incur ABC, activity-based costing, how much cost will incur in performing a particular activity. If in a paint shop, if you are painting a product, the how much cost is incurring in painting a particular product, a product, maybe you are painting 100 products per day, then how much the cost of one product is incurring painting. So what we'll calculate? We'll calculate the machine hours, machine depreciations, then the how much humans are there engaged in that painting shops and all. So we calculate activity-based costing. The operational business model identifies the cost and outputs of each activity, right? So that is, in order to perform activities, an organization requires human tangible, intangible, and supporting resources. Tangible, intangible, we know. Tangible, to which we can touch, and intangible, where we are unable to touch. Human resources in particular, the skills and knowledge of employees are important, as are the programs, incentives, training, and all institutional that support them in case of, right? And tangible or physical and financial resources include facilities, equipment, and cash reserves. We need all the things to run a business. We need human resources, we need finances, we need other resources, equipments, land, equipment, building, and all. Intangible resources include intellectual property, business processes that can be patented, business processes. Right, converting the process of converting or modifying input into output. Right, branding, brands, it is again an intangible thing. Customer profiles and personalization data in database and customized softwares, these all are intangible things. Branding softwares we are using because most of the even the manufacturing processes are automated now. We'll be using multiple enterprise resource planning like softwares. Supporting systems include organizational structure, information system, or communication. Processes that may have little value as standalone resources. So we have tangible and intangible things, tangible and intangible resources to produce, right, the output. So this is about the different types of resources. Multiple types of resources are needed to perform the activity. Multiple types of different types of resources are needed to perform activities. Resources and, right? Now, the today's last topic is capacity. You all may be aware with the capacity and capacity planning. Capacity. The total resources of an organization represent its capacity. Total resources of the organization. If one organization is building a bulb, electric bulb, LED bulb, and they own a small startup and manufacturing LED bulb, and the machine can manufacture a maximum number of 500 bulbs per day. The highest capacity is 500. And they may not be able to produce in standard maximum capacity per day, 500 per day bulbs. That is the capacity. When resources are underutilized, the company has resources that are not used or idle capacity. Idle capacity, suppose if you have demand or if you are manufacturing only 200 bulbs instead of you have capacity of manufacturing 500 LEBs with that machine, but you are manufacturing only 200. That is, the machine is idle more than 50% of the time. This is, we say, idle capacity. Idle capacity in manufacturing tends to be measured in terms of additional output that could be produced. The 300 bulbs we can produce more, but it remains idle for most of the time because no demand. In service organizations, the measure for idle capacity is usually a number of employees. If in a barber shop, three employees are there in a haircutting salon, in barber shop, and only one customer at a time is there in lockdown, the capacity, the maximum capacity is three at a time, but only one customer they are getting at a time. So two-third of their capacity will remain idle for the whole day. The number of human beings, getting the difference, in service organizations, right? In service organizations, the measure for idle capacity is usually a number of employees. Normally, a number of employees. Maybe in service organization. If we talk about hotel, the measure may be the number of rooms. If we talk about the restaurant, the measure may be kitchen, number of people in the kitchen, in service, and all. Lot of number of different ways we can. But normally humans in case of service, right? Resource capacity can also be measured in hours. We measure in hours, man hours, basically. Man hours, machine hours, sales per employee. Sales in marketing and sales, they measure in sales basically. If they sold around 500 units per month, then they can divide by number of salesmen and sales per employee. Per day or per month or whatever, or square feet in real estate. Often these are compared with industry standards to assess the efficiency of the organization. Basically, capacity and what we are using, these are related with the efficiency of the organization, how efficiently the organization is working. If the production is 100%, no idle capacity, we are using the full capacity, then the organization's efficiency is it will be 100%. Otherwise, or if they are using manufacturing only 250 bulbs, the machine is able to manufacture 500, but manufacturing only 250, the efficiency will be 50%. That is needed. So this is for the day on that topic, right? And